Do you know what the ACID principles of databases are and why they're important? The ACID principles help understand how databases work. They're key to understanding the differences between SQL and NoSQL databases. The first step is actually to understand what problems databases are trying to solve. But first, have you ever wondered the extent to which databases are involved in pretty much everything that we do? When I log into a website, I buy a gadget and I have it delivered to my home. At each of these stages, my actions give rise to a record in a database somewhere. And in fact, even the money that I used to pay is not much more than a database entry. Now imagine you're tasked with developing the database that manages the transactions for the bank within the bank. Or if that's too scary, imagine you're the developer of a massively multiplayer online game, an MMO, and you're in charge of coding the exchange of virtual items for in-game currency between players. Now let's break that down. Let's imagine an example. The first player, let's call him Abe, has 100 gold coins in his account. He wants to use 10 of those to buy the hero's legendary sword, sold by player Bill, who has 990 gold coins. How would you need to implement this to avoid cheating? If you think about it, the logic itself is fairly simple. We look at how many coins Abe has, so in this case 100. If he has enough, we take 10 away, which leaves him with 90. We then add 10 to Bill's account, who now has 1,000. Then we take away the legendary sword from Bill and we give it to Abe. That would seem to work. But imagine that there are millions of exchanges taking place simultaneously. Imagine that Charlie has also initiated a purchase of Bill's legendary sword at exactly the same time. Imagine that Abe is also trying to buy the epic sword of strength, which costs 95 gold at the same time, and so he doesn't have enough money to buy both. Imagine that one of the servers doing the calculations crashes while managing exchanges. Imagine that there's a fire that brings the whole system to its knees. Designing a software system is often about imagining everything that can go wrong. Maybe video game developers can afford to take a few shortcuts. After all, even if the sword is legendary, the fate of the world doesn't really rest on its wildest shoulders. But if we're talking about a bank, if we're talking about a few million dollars being transferred, the impact of a bug becomes a lot more significant. How can we build a system that survives this kind of problem? Well, if you think about it, you'll find it's far from trivial. This exchange, be it in gaming or in banking, is what's known in database terminology as a transaction. And to be resilient, to be able to survive, to be bug-free, there are four rules that transactions should follow. These four rules give rise to the ACID acronym. Andreas Reuter and Thomas Heder from Germany, who came up with the acronym, are actually engaging in a bit of dev humor here because ACID rules are for databases. Do you get it? So, what does ACID stand for? A stands for atomicity, C stands for consistency, I stands for isolation, and D stands for durability. The simplest to understand, or perhaps just for me to explain, is durability. In short, if you switch the database off and then switch it on again, you're not losing any of the data that it holds. To put it simply, the database is stored on a permanent storage. Now, isolation is the fact that each transaction operates independently of the other. Let's explore that together. Let's take the case of money being transferred. The simplest version of a transfer between two accounts reads the amount from both accounts, increments the first one, decreases the other, and writes all that to the base. But imagine that there are two transfers of, say, $20 and $10 each, which arrive simultaneously on an account that has $100. If transaction A reads the amount from the account, it reads 100. Then transaction B also reads 100 from the account. Transaction A then calculates the sum with 20 more, so that's 120, and writes that to base. But then transaction B calculates the sum corresponding to 10 more than what it read, so that's 110, and then writes that to the base. As B read the amount from the account before A wrote it, the account is noted as having $110 instead of the 130 which it should. Because the two transactions ran at the same time, the end result was wrong. Isolation prevents transactions from interfering with each other. Each transaction takes its turn. Consistency, since we seem to be going backwards through the ACID acronym, means that we never write an inconsistent result to the database. We only write consistent final results. Finally, atomicity means transactions function as a whole. A transaction can't work or fail halfway. Everything works or nothing works. These four characteristics guarantee, or at least help the system to work as intended. And since we're on the subject, SQL databases have been designed to meet this transactional use case and to try and fit as closely as possible to the ACID rules. Now, on a side note, there's no point in a database being ACID compliant if the transaction logic checks take place in the server code and not in the database, because application code is rarely ACID compliant. Following ACID principles is a requirement for bug-free transactions, but ACID rules are a difficult constraint. ACID rules have a cost in terms of performance, of complexity, of scalability and speed. And that's actually why NoSQL databases were created, because you see, not everything is a transaction. Sometimes you don't need full durability. Sometimes you only need eventual consistency. And NoSQL databases set aside this or that aspect of ACID rules in order to solve a specific problem like speed or scaling. We'll cover this in more depth when we talk about the opposition between NoSQL and SQL databases. But before we go there, it's also worth noting that ACID rules also have a huge impact on the logical structure of a database, on how we organize what is stored where. Imagine, for example, that the same piece of data, the price of an item, for example, or the amount that an account holds, is stored in several places. This multiplies the number of places that need to be read and written in order for the transaction to work, and that produces bugs. The data itself needs to be organized in a way that eliminates duplication and repetition. This is what we call database normalization, and that's going to be the subject of this video here. I'll see you there.